Let the preacher come. in Jesus' name. And all of us can say it, amen. God bless you. I wish you may be seated. Hide and seek. One particular quiet evening, my mother and I were reminiscing about the life of her mother, my grandmother. And my mother told me that at nighttime, when my grandmother would prepare me for bed, she would play a game with me. The game was called Hide and Seek. I'm told that my grandmother would turn off all the lights, put me on the floor, and allow me to crawl away. I was told that my grandmother would then get on her knees and attempt to find me. My mother stated that two things stood out to her. One, how well I could see in the dark. Two, how her mother, my grandmother, could crawl around on her knees. I am told that my grandmother would call out to me and say, "Michael, where are you?" I'm told that I was a giggler, so my giggle would always give away my location. My mother also told me something that I find relevant for this exercise. My mother advised me that I always hid in the same spot. Therefore, it was never difficult, even in darkness, to locate me if you were familiar with the spot. And I wonder, do I have any believers in the house who are familiar with their prayer spot? You see, the Georgia Mass Choir said it this way: come on in my room. Jesus is my doctor, and he writes down all my prescriptions. He gives me all my medicine in my room. Do I have any believers in the house who have had to visit their room lately? I can't speak for you, but I have had to visit my room on a daily basis. And you see, in this life, there is a lot of stuff going on that requires us to stay prayed up. I'm discovering that prayer doesn't always work it out in my favor, because not everything that I want, God wants for me. But he does keep me from nothing up and losing my mind. And do I have anyone in here that knows God as a heart fixer and a mind regulator? Philippians chapter 4 and 7 teaches us that the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your heart and mind in Christ Jesus. That's right, church folks. Somebody ought to bless God right now for keeping you from nutting up on your co-worker, nutting up on your next door neighbor, nutting up on your baby's daddy, nutting up on your baby's mama, nutting up on your lazy behind children, nutting up on the ignorant person you encountered in Sam's Club this week, nutting up on a disinterested caseworker, or nutting up on an unappreciative spouse. Won't God keep you in perfect? I wish I had some help in here. Our unit, our selected portion of the sacred text, is housed in the poetic writings of the Psalms. Somebody say Psalms. Psalms are sacred poetry that was used in ancient Israelite and Judean worship. The Psalms were appropriated, preserved, and transferred. And not only as a record of human response to God, but also as God's words to humanity. Well, Walter Bergerman states that generation of Jews and Christians have found Psalms to be a reliable resource for the articulation of faith, but also for the authentic articulation of life and its complexities. Scholars suggest that we read both Psalm 9 and Psalm 10 together, for together they are a song of the people of God who live in faith in the reign of God in the midst of the afflictions of history. This song, somebody say song. Song. This song is a lament by an individual who is persecuted and oppressed by wicked persons and who calls to the Lord for help. The Psalter complains that the Lord is absent in the time of trouble when the wicked persecute the lowly. But the Psalter is in a bad place, beloved, in his or her life. She is trying to do the best she can, but trouble seems to be on every side. But the Psalter pronounces a praise to God in Psalm 99 when she says, "The Lord is a stronghold for the oppressed, a stronghold in the time of trouble." But he turns right around in Psalm 10 and 1 and complains by saying, "Why, O Lord, do you stand far off? Why do you hide yourself in times of trouble?" I'm perplexed at this piece because I'm trying to figure out what is really going on. What is really happening here in the writing of the Psalter? Why is the Psalter full of praise and confidence in Psalm 9 and cussing and fussing in Psalm 10? I wish I had some help in here. Could it be, St. Paul, that the Psalter has become impatient? Somebody say impatient. Could it be that the Psalter has become impatient and indignant? Somebody say indignant. It is clear that the Psalter is dealing with unsettled circumstances. Now, look at your worship partner. Say neighbor or neighbor. Unsettled circumstances. Is there anybody in the house today familiar with unsettled circumstances? Let me see if I can help somebody. Unsettled circumstances are the things in life that we seek to wrestle with every week. Pardon me, health care for aging parents classified as unsettled circumstances. Dialysis classifies as unsettled circumstances. Ongoing chemotherapy classifies as unsettled circumstances. Waiting for an agency approval for the continuation of a federal grant qualifies as unsettled circumstances. Constant unemployment qualifies as unsettled circumstances. Immature children that think that they are grown or grown behind children who refuse to grow up can classify as unsettled circumstances. Unsettled circumstances, my beloved, can cause one to be impatient and indignant towards God. But I'm still not satisfied. I'm still not satisfied. I've got to dig a little deeper. I've got to get up under the text. And when I dug deeper, I discovered, Terry, that impatience and indignation is a direct product of incomprehensible delay. Look at your neighbor. Say neighbor or neighbor. Sometimes I don't understand why it's taking so long. I wish I had some help in here. Yes, Terry. It is in those unsettled circumstances that produce incomprehensible delays that cause the believer to become impatient and indignant with God. I wish I had some help in here. You see, in other words, we as believers are unable to comprehend God's absolute reign. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor, I've got to understand God's absolute reign. You see, some of us have embraced that God's delay is not God's denial. But Mr. Ford, some of us have a tremendous challenge under understanding why God takes so long when the pain is so tough, so harsh, and unbearable. And Mrs. Spence, my job is to ask where God is in the text. My theological response is that God invites the believer into the absolute reign of God. You see, God is actively moving, creating, and developing in the world so much that as believers, we must understand that delay and victory, delay and triumph live under the same roof of God. Somebody missed it. Beloved, God is not playing a game of hide and seek with our lives. God is where God always has been and where God always is. The believer must battle the urge to be impatient and indignant due to unsettled circumstances. I wish I had some help in here. The believer must stand firm in God's reign in spite of incomprehensible delays by trusting. Y'all ready to get on the train? Open it up. Y'all ready to get on the train? First of all, you got to trust in, number one, the proximity of God. You've got to trust in the proximity of God. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor. Or neighbor. Don't believe that lie. God is close to you. I wish I had some help in here. Beloved, never allow incomprehensible delays to convince you that God is not near. Help me, Holy Ghost. You see, God does not leave us in times of trouble. God does not abandon us when haters want to destroy us. God has not taken a vacation when disaster strikes. When all hell breaks loose on the job, in our homes, with our family, with our finances, with our friends, with our church, trust in the proximity of God. In fact, the Psalter writes in Psalm 46 that God is my refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Now, look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, oh neighbor, God has never left me. Oh no, your neighbor just looked at you and they rolled your eyes. They rolled their eyes at you. What you mean? God has never left you. I've seen some of the stuff that you've gone through. I've watched you cry. I've watched you try to make it on ends meet. What you mean God has never left you? How do you know that God has never left you? I want you to look at your neighbor. Look them back in the eye. Look them straight in the eye. Say, I know because I never would have made it without God in my life. Now, what I need you to do right now, I need you to pull the cover back. Pull the cover back and take a quick tour of your life. Yeah, right now, you need to pull the cover back, baby. Because, see, some of us in here trying to cover up all that mess. Some of us in here trying to cover up all that stuff. Some of us trying to cover up all that pain. Some of us trying to cover up all the pain. Right now, you need to pull the cover back. Come on, pull that cover back. Pull the cover back and take a quick tour of your life. Now, if you were to be totally honest with yourself, you would have to say nobody but you, God. Yeah, I wish I had some help in here. Nobody but you could have brought me through that illness. Nobody but you, God, could have healed me from that disease. No, nobody but you, God, could have gotten me through school. Nobody but you, God, could have kept me safe while I was operating machinery and drunk as a skunk. Nobody but you, God, could have brought me out of an abusive relationship.
as God said to the salt, I didn't leave you, baby. Yeah, the footprint that you see on mine, I carried you through. And do I have anybody up in here that would like to lift their voice and say, thank you, God, for being closer than my sister, closer than my brother, closer than my mama, closer than my daddy. Thank you, God, for carrying me through this and carrying me through today. Do I have anybody up in here? You got a praise in your belly right now because God carried you through this and God carried you through that. Yeah, you thought you had it up on the front arm in a bag of chips, but you found out what that was. Look at your neighbor, say neighbor, oh neighbor, say neighbor, oh neighbor, the evidence is in the trial. The proof of God, because of incomprehensible delays, the Psalter was unable to see evidence of God's concern. The Psalter was so wrapped up in the problem that the Psalter failed to see the overwhelming evidence of God's activity. Beloved, just because God has not moved you doesn't mean that God is not in looking for a miracle, that you fail to see the miracle that God is performing before your very eyes. Some of us are guilty of church hopping, looking for a feel-good word instead of listening for the voice of God speaking in you. Beloved, the weak believer looks for evidence in the victory. The weak believer looks for evidence in the trial. The works are in the trial. But the strong believer looks for evidence in the delay. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor, oh neighbor, there is evidence in the delay. You see, for it is in the delay that we must trust God more. It is in the delay that we must serve God more. It is in the delay that we must develop a radical praise for the awesome activity of God. Only God, only God, only God can take 9 precious lives and cause George Wallace's Alabama to take down that Confederate flag. Only God can take 9 precious lives and on the week of their homegoing celebration have not one but 2 Supreme Court rulings that preserves the rights of humanity in these United States of America. I wish I had a strong believer that was in the middle of their delay that would tell their neighbor, say, neighbor, oh neighbor, the Lord what you can smell.
Looked at Jamal.